My name is Kylie Michael. I am the Family Consumer Sciences teacher here at Ragland High School. I know most of you know me already, but I wanted to go ahead and introduce myself. I am making this presentation on behalf of a graduate level class at Jacksonville State University, and I'm going to be talking to you about a preposition for a diversity plan that I have after studying some demographics and some data that we have, and looking at some of the underachieving students and how we can get them to a place of achieving, okay? So the first thing I want to start by telling you is a little disclaimer. All of this data is from the 2018-2019 year, because the data for the 2019-2020 year is not available yet. I'm assuming that's because of COVID, so there was a lot of tests that were canceled and that kind of stuff, and so I know data's not quite as accurate because we had all that craziness go on. So the first thing I'm going to start with is, obviously, this is Ragland High School in St. Clair County, Alabama. In grades 7 to 12, we have about 200 students, and as for me, I teach about 120 of them, because I teach all of 7th grade, all of 8th grade, all of 9th grade, and then when they get to 10th through 12, they start breaking into other things like Spanish or driver's ed and health, just different classes like that, so I don't get all of them once we get to that point. We are a 1A Title I school, very rural. K through 12 is a very small town, as you know. Overall, for the 2018-2019 year, we had a grade of B on the Alabama State Department of Education report card, because we had proficiency rates all under 50% for math, science, and reading. Just some of the basic demographics, you can see how this is a breakdown of the different ethnicities that we have. So we have Asian, African American, Pacific Islander, white, biracial, so two or more races, Hispanic, and then American Indian. So you can see that the white population and the African American population take up a large percentage of the students that we have here. So just giving you that background information so that you can know kind of where the ethnicities differ in reference to proficiency levels. So for this plan, I chose two subgroups, and the two subgroups that we're gonna look at is students with disabilities and students with limited English proficiency, also known as ELL students. And the reason I chose these, because they had the highest percentages in the needs support category of proficiency. So that's why I chose them. And you can see looking here, the percentages of students with disabilities in reading, they're at about 65%. For science, they're at about 50%. And for math, they're about 65%. And then the EIL students is pretty similar. You see a little bit of difference in science, so you can just see that how their needs support ranks based on the category that they're in. So my plan is, I want to present a diversity plan to you, meaning what can we do for these two groups of students, students with disabilities and students with ELL, what can we do to get them performing on grade level and get these percentages of need support down so that they're performing either on grade level or at least close to grade level, okay? So the three things I want to present to you is, number one, I think we need to conduct a needs assessment on the students and families so that we can know their needs outside of school. Number two, we need to do a needs assessment on the teachers so we can address what's going on and how they're assisting students. And then number three, we need to implement some type of program, either online or in the classroom, to raise student achievement in the desired area, whether that be science, math, reading, writing, whatever category you're trying to improve. Okay, so let's look at this first step. When I talk about assessing student and family needs, what I'm talking about is, I know you've heard before of Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And basically his study said that students can't perform or really do anything else until their basic needs are met. So on the bottom level, you've got things like food, water, sleep, stuff like that. And so if the students aren't having those needs met at home, meaning they're not getting fed regularly, they don't have a warm place to lay their head, they're not getting water, that kind of stuff, then obviously they're not going to perform well at school. They're not going to be able to have that level of achievement that we are trying to get them to on grade level. So what we can do as a community is we can look at, are their needs being met? And we know, since we're a Title I school, that we have a lot of students whose needs aren't being met. So if we can identify that, then we can start getting grants or getting some type of program together to start getting those needs met so that we can get them to where they need to be. Okay. Second thing is, we need to identify the disabilities. If we don't know what's going on with our students, what disabilities they have, there's no way we can improve their learning. So what do they need in reference to their disability? Do they need more technology available? Do they need help writing? Do they need help reading? What do they need? Okay, so in order to improve them, we've got to figure out what they need. Okay, we also need to identify the language barriers. This is for ELL students. So are their parents speaking in a different language at home? Because if so, that might be hard when they come to school, trying to decipher what is going on in school and decipher what's going on at home. So what resources can we provide the parents at home to ensure that they're helping their student get on level language-wise at school? And then so once we know all of those needs, we can make a plan for what do we need specifically to address those needs. So is it we need some type of money so that we can feed kids? Is it that we need some type of program so that we can improve kids? We need to figure out what is our plan of action and how can we go forward, but we can't do that until we know what specifically the students need, okay? Second thing we need to look at is the teacher's needs. If professional development is not doing something that the teachers actually need, then it's kind of wasted. So we need to be able to provide professional development that actually is related to these categories. So I know, like me specifically, I don't have a lot of training on assisting students with ELL. So maybe we can get somebody in here that can just tell us, like, hey, here's what you should do, or here's a good idea that works, or here's something that I know that has worked in my classroom. And if we can do that, then we can help those students with ELL. What we're seeking to find with this question is, are teachers prepared to address these issues? Are teachers readily available to help ELL students? Are they readily available to help students with disabilities? And we're not going to know that until we assess what their needs are. And once we do that, we can make sure that they're prepared by doing different trainings or doing different lessons or whatever we need to do to get teachers to where they need to be so that students can get where they need to be, okay? And then the third thing is we need to implement some type of program. So for students with disabilities, my two ideas is number one, we can implement an online learning program that allows the student to demonstrate based on their disability. So if they can't write a paper like by hand, maybe they can type it. Or if they can't answer questions on paper, maybe they can do them online. Some type of program, once we figure out specifically what the student's needs are, some type of program that we can implement so that they can have some way to express their knowledge in a different way than maybe your traditional student. Okay, the second thing is we can provide internet and computer access to these students so that they have technology assistance through a grant. I had a student last year who was graduating and he had a disability and he was wheelchair bound because of it. And so I remember there was a day where a college person came in and met with him and talked about things that they could do to get him to be able to participate in college still. And it was things like the computer would talk to him or he could talk to the computer since he couldn't move his arms and legs. They found a way to use technology to help them. And we can do the same thing for our students. And even that means that we have to get grants or whatever, we can do the same type of thing to make sure that our students are they have the necessary resources to perform where they need to. Okay, the next thing is for ELL learners, and so I figured out three things that I think we could do. Number one is online language learning systems. There is tons of free ones online that you can do. There's like USA Learns, that's just one specifically I know, but if we can have them on that 45 minutes a day, sometime a free period, like maybe they have an enrichment class or a goal class or during like their PE, maybe they could spend time on that, and that will help bridge that transition between the English language learning, okay? Second thing we can do as instructors is provide translations for assignments and assessments. Like maybe we provide them a copy in Spanish while they're learning to switch from one language to another. Now I know the goal is ultimately to get them to perform on an English level, but we can provide those translations while they're learning. And then the third thing is assess the resources provided for students. So we can figure out from the students, do they need more things at home? Like, do they need a computer? Do they need internet? Do they need paper copies? Like, what do they need to be more successful? So then the conclusion of this plan is, the whole idea of this plan is to get the two subgroups, which is students with disabilities and English language learners, onto grade level. And so three main steps that I talked about that we could do is complete a needs assessment on the students, complete a needs assessment on the teachers, and then implement some type of program to get them where they need to be. And if we can do all these three things successfully, I think we could get that percentage of needs category down and get more students performing on grade level. And that was the whole point of this, is to get those students where they need to be. So these are just simple things that we can do that is meeting their needs and meeting that diversity requirement, so that we can make sure that we're making them as successful as we can. So thank you very much.